Thank you very much. The results I'm going to talk about today are part of a fantastic collaborative project, and my name's Kate Wellham. Not all of us sadly can be here today, but I'm delighted that Chloe Duckworth from the University of Leicester is in the audience. And we also should acknowledge our lovely funders, the Society of Antiquaries, because they paid for this work to be done. I'm going to talk about the combination of geophysical and geochemical survey and how that can help us understand much more about sites. And why are you filming me, Chloe? Isn't there enough? And how that can help us understand more about the layout of sites and the activities that happen on sites. But more importantly, what I want to discuss today is the relationship between geophysical and geochemical survey and the reflexive nature of that relationship. And maybe rather than just seeing things differently, about how we should be thinking about things differently when it comes to prospection. And the site we're going to be looking at as a case study is a site in southern Spain, an Islamic site. And in particular, I'm going to be talking about portable XRF, and we'll talk more about that later, and geophysical survey. So the combination of geophysics and geochemistry is not a new concept. There's been lots and lots of sites and fantastic projects that have used it. And for example, this is just another project that I've been involved with out in Tanzania on an Islamic stone town. And we've got, hopefully if this comes on, some very nice geophysics from an electromagnetic survey we did. And there's a lovely Islamic stone town here with a palace. And then some big blobs, you can see, highlighted. And the geophysics showed us that actually we could reveal a hidden population of people living on this site who were previously unknown, and their wattle and daub huts, which you can see up there. And the geochemistry told us about what those people were doing in those huts and how they were keeping areas like the one in the middle clean, and probably sweeping it clean and possibly use it for shell working, etc. That's great. That's given us a lot more information beyond being able to dig the site. But of course, the reality was that I collected this data in the field. Whilst the excavation was going on, we could look at the data, we could discuss it, and we went home again. While that was going on, we were sampling over a 5 metre grid over the site, putting little bits of soil in bags, sending it back to the UK, and Frederica Soulas was then analysing it in ICP and getting the data. And then probably about a year down the line, we were able to put all this together in GIS and start really discussing it. And it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of money, and it kind of disarticulates the two things. So looking back, as Mark talked about at the beginning, it's 16 years since, and I'm going to mention the hodder word, discussed, which is very unusual for me, as Mark will know, discussed moving towards a more reflexive approach. And the concept of archaeological science at the trail's edge, and I'm sure many of you will be aware of the work that Hodder and Matthews and others did out in Tatapoyac, trying to bring archaeological science much more to the active excavation process and that integration and what that might be. Now, that's a long time ago, and the challenge has always been with things like geochemistry is that just as here, we've had to get the soil, we don't have our ICP sitting in the very small hut at Songo Minahara, and it's just impossible. But of course, things have moved on. And one of the things that's moved on for geochemistry is the development over the past decade of portable XRF. And so for those of you who are maybe not so familiar with the technique, portable X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy, XRF itself is not new to archaeology. It's been around since the 60s. Very popular, fantastic way of analysing a whole range of inorganic materials from metals, ceramics, soil sediments, rocks, minerals. Wonderful. Predominantly laboratory based. But in the last decade, we've seen the development of these fantastic Star Wars type tricorder type devices. And this is Derek Pittman, hard at work in 40 degree heat. This has really enabled us to take chemical analysis into the field. Now, I know, and I'm sure you do, that there are lots of problems about our understanding of how the chemistry of soils actually can be related to human actions and processes that get those chemicals into the soils and how they're formed. And we're still really at the beginning of our understanding of that. But one of the areas where I think we can make some big leaps forward, and indeed work has already started to show this, is when we're trying to look at sites with high temperature production activities. And there's already been some great work, not least by Derek Pittman himself and his colleagues out in Russia. And here in this slide, you can see this is work he's done in the Urals in Russia at a Middle Bronze Age site, Santasha, and they've been looking at the organisation of metal production, copper-based metal production. And these dots represent a 2-metre grid, and using portable XRF, looking at copper concentrations. And by using a combination of that with geophysics and with excavation, they've started to highlight areas where copper production is taking place and reinterpret how that society on a large scale is using and working metals. So I want to talk about another case study that we've been doing that looks at this combined approach to try and understand the development of production, high temperature production technologies. And it's part of a much wider project. We're looking at the Islamic world, but in Spain. And we're very interested in how glass and ceramic production in particular is integrated into the development of these urban centres in Spain. And particularly the reason behind that is because it tells us a lot about technology transfer and the relationships between the Christian and Muslim and Jewish worlds at this time and out into the Mediterranean. So that's kind of where we're coming from. And in these large urban centres, what we see is a huge amount of both ceramic and glass being produced to do things like make beautiful glazed tiles that you can see here. And we're doing it on quite a grand scale. So here you can see Chloe and David peering into a very large ceramic furnace reconstructed at the Alhambra in Granada. And so whether it's to make these beautiful tiles or whether it's to create new mints to showcase the power of these centres, these production technologies are very, very important to identity, status, wealth, all sorts of things. And we're looking at one site in particular. So we get to go to Spain, which is very nice, to southern Spain, just here, Andalusia. And it's a site called Madinat al Zahra, which is just a few kilometres outside of Cordoba. And it's a large site with a palace, a beautiful palace built in the mid 10th century and abandoned in the 11th century. And we know a lot about the palace. It was built to showcase the power of the caliphate in that region. And it's very beautiful. The architecture and the palace itself have been studied. However, this palace is not by itself. It sits within a almost 100 hectare medina or city that has, by contrast, not been looked at really at all, which is a bonus for us because the good thing about the medina, so there's a palace in the middle, medina, kind of like all this area in between, all this sort of blank area. Since the palace was abandoned in the 11th century, there's really not been very much modern occupation. And today, it's all part of the actual site, and there's maybe a little bit of grazing from cows on it. So it's been largely protected, which is fantastic news for us as archaeologists. But of course, going out there trying to understand where the production is, we've got historical texts that tell us that this site, perfect archaeological site, has probably got evidence of this production. And so we wanted to find it. Where do you start in an almost 100 hectare site that's had nothing done on it before and has just got a couple of aerial photos? So I'm always optimistic. We went for a week, thought that's enough. And we started down here, and I'm going to talk about why we started and what we did as I go through. And we decided to use a couple of techniques. Because the site was so large, we thought we'd approach it using magnetics, flux gate gradiometry survey. And that's what you can see up here, because this is something we can do relatively quickly. Cover a reasonable amount of ground. It's quite rough ground. It's not suitable for cart-based systems, in case some of you are thinking, why don't we just bring in a Land Rover? Unfortunately, it's not suitable for that. And we did actually test as well some electromagnetic survey, but that didn't work so well. But I can talk to you more about the different techniques if anyone wants to afterwards. But we also took Derek and his portable XRF machine. And so we focused in on an area, and we conducted quite coarse survey because we wanted to cover a large area quickly. And so from the Bartingtons, the magnetometers here, we're looking at just a quick one-by-one survey. But with the XRF, we took a 20-meter grid, which is fairly large. And so you can see here, this is the area in the dark where we did the geophysics, and all the dots represent the XRF points. And then Derek also went for a very long walk one day out with his XRF to test a transect right across the site, and also to get some very important background data on the site as well. Now, why did we start here? Well, we did have a bit of a clue. There are a couple of aerial photos, and in this region, which is just there, there's clear evidence of possible buildings. No one knows what these are. I don't think we still do, actually. But we thought they might, if there was going to be a candidate for workshops anywhere, that could be it. So that's why we started over there. But we found several things. The big bonus was we found that actually the soil at Madinat is relatively chemically quiet, which is really good news for doing XRF. We also found that there's a lot of wasps in Andalusia in July. So that's enough. Fortunately, none of us are allergic to it. But this is the geophysics. So here you've got the whole of the region with the black outline. And you can see this building comes up very nicely. It's absolutely enormous. It's got huge walls. It's got lots of divisions. It's got all sorts of stuff. Still no idea really what it's for. But what we were interested in is where's the production? And we did find that there were probably hints at some production, possibly butting up against the side of this building. Some small hints. But then we found this enormous disturbance up the top. And we're going to talk more about that disturbance and the time and date of when it was found and why we went there, which is very important. So from the geophysics alone, we know a bit, but certainly not enough to really pinpoint anything about whether this was metal or glass or ceramic. And we can spot that there's some iron working, but beyond that, it's getting a bit tricky. This is the XRF data. And so this has been this collection. We've got over 500 points here. And it's actually been put into GIS and Creed for those of you who are interested. But we have also looked at the raw data and looked at them to check they're statistically significant. And what we started to see was in these three fairly heavy elements here, which are related to production either through glazed ceramics. So there's very famous ceramics from Madinat that are lead glazed with manganese in them. We started to see this big hotspot starting to come up here. And as I said before, we could be certain because of the background work that we did on the site that this is actually a real hotspot as opposed to the gold hotspot that Derek found for about 2 hours when we got quite excited and then went and tested it, disappeared. But these are actually really, really there. So that's telling us something about that top corner. And when we look at the combined results, what we see is actually that part there with the geophysics. When we start pulling apart more, we can see you may just be able to make out that that top anomaly looks rather like a keyhole. And that furnace I showed you earlier looks rather like a keyhole. And so it looks like we've got something going on here that I would suggest is indicative of one of these, hopefully one of these high temperature production techniques, ceramic production in particular. Now, that's quite amazing to do that. We were lucky in a week, but were we so lucky? And this is, I suppose, where I want to really kind of just to think about. We were lucky we had Derek with us and his XRF, but we nearly didn't go there. As Chloe will attest, we had 2 hours left. It was the last day, it always is. And it was very hot. it was nearly 40 degrees. And we had to make a decision. We'd done this nice block of survey, and we had to decide whether to go out here and try and explore out, because we knew we wanted to come back, or whether to go north. And we looked at the geochemistry data to do that. There is no way we could have done that if we'd had to sample the data and take it back home again, take a sample of the soil and go back home and sit there. This use of geophysics and geochemistry in tandem, one informing the other, is something that I think certainly I'm not used to. It made me think very differently about the way I might approach sites in the future. And I think the potential for the XRF, despite all the problems we know about, to help us be more interpretive on site, not necessarily here at the trowel's edge, but certainly at the magnetometer's edge, is really, really important. And if it wasn't for that, we wouldn't have been able to put in the grant application to the British Academy, and we wouldn't have just got funded to go back and find out more. So I'm really delighted about the way this has worked, and I'd like to just sort of encourage, I suppose, more people to engage with this technique so we can test it and try and understand how we can go forward. And if anyone has any production sites or sites where they think they might have production and they're interested in this type of approach, I'd be very keen to speak to you, because I think the only way to develop it is to test it and test it and test it. Thank you very much.